Good evening, everyone. Okay, settle down.
They fall off, they rattle.
Settle down, get louder, sir.
What's that?
Want to call to order the regular scheduled New Carlisle City Council meeting for October 17th, 2016 at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier, when you're ready. Mayor Lowry, here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. Kraybauer?
Here.
All present.
Thank you, sir. If you'll stand, we'll have tonight's invocation by Councilman Ethan Reynolds.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings that you've given us in this great city, Lord. Thank you for letting us live in the freest country, one of the freest nations in the world, Father, Lord. Give us the wisdom and bless us to make the decisions that will affect all of our citizens' lives, even ourselves. Amen.
And we'll do tonight's pledge. We'll use the flag in the back. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we're going to need actions on the regular scheduled council meeting for October 3rd, 2016. We'll have to do these individually, correct? Mr. Mayor? Mr. Lindsay?
Forgot what I'm saying. So moved.
Second.
I second. I heard.
Any questions, council? Mr. Collier?
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Abstain.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybauer?
Yep.
Minutes passed, 6-0-1.
Thank you, sir. And then we'll need Mr. Reynolds.
Move to approve special meeting minutes from 10-11-16.
Second. I heard two.
Whichever one.
Mr. Kraybauer? Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybauer?
Yes.
Passes 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to city manager's report. Mr. Bridge, good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of public. It's good to see a good turnout this evening, so as always, we are happy to see everyone here. I would like to share with everyone the city manager's report, starting off with our finance discussion, our finance director, Mrs. Colleen Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Mayor, council, and members of the public, I'm going to try and speak up a little bit as I go through the September finance report. Our revenues for September was $404,643.38. Our September expenditures was $493,960.90. So our year-to-date total revenue collected is $4,796,220.23. And for our total expenditures to date is $3,643,600.33. On with the income tax collection, the general fund collected for the month of September $76,548.92, and the half percent police income tax collected $38,476.02 for the month of September. That brings the year-to-date total in the general fund for our income tax collection at $880,733.61. And for our income tax for the half percent police income is $431,861.84. On the second page of my report, I have my standard pool revenue report through September. But I actually had some requests to get it updated today, so I have submitted a second page that I just passed out. I have a few extra if anybody would like them up here on the counter. what this is going to represent, if everybody's on the same page, the one that's titled 2016 pool report, that is the total revenue and expenditures today, as of today. So I'm going to go through, and I'll try to make this a real quick comparison. Our revenue for the pool season for 2016, we collected $67,558.15. That is $25,000 over our estimated revenue that we projected when we did our budget. So as you can see on the left side, I have it written down, that's our budget. That's what we thought we were estimating is bringing in as revenue and expenditures. The writers is our actual revenue and expense. On the expenditures for the pool for the season today, wages, we spent $33,066.52. We budgeted a little over $47,000, so we came in under budget on that. Utilities, I printed out in red because I do have two more pending Verizon invoices, and what those are for the iPads that the pool used, and they bill us in the rear. Howie has already had those canceled, so the next bill, I estimated that payment in there, so that red is including that. Maintenance of facilities, maintenance of equipment. You can kind of go down the line. The other one in red is our liability insurance, the $3,500. That'll be paid in November. So on the contractual total for the pool season, it should be $20,628. And we budgeted $25,000. So we came in under budget on that, those items also. The next set is the concessions. We estimated that we'd spend $8,000. I put this number also in the red because I have two little Visa charges that are out there that I have not got the invoice for. But I'm anticipating that at $5,330 for concession expenditures, operating supplies, chemicals. All of this totals $15,694 for the season. We budgeted $20,000. Again, we came in under budget on our expenditures. Startup fee, the only reason that's a little higher, we estimated $550, is we did have merchant fees since we used the credit card this year that's in there. So it's a lot of information, but basically as of today, the best guess I can put in for our ending balances, revenue is a definite. We took in the $67,558.15. Expenditures, I believe, is going to end at $70,004.67 for a pool loss for the season of $2,446. We did transfer last year from the general fund. We had a little bit extra that stayed in the fund after that transfer of $4,657. So that will cover the expenditures this year. I do not anticipate transferring any money from the general fund to cover the pool for this season. So it was an excellent year. You had efforts in the income was definitely over and above what we estimated, and the expenditures, they kept the pool expenditures down. So I wanted to give that information to you again. I can answer any questions later, or you can contact me at the office for any more detail, but that was what I wanted to report for our ending pool season, since that's always a good topic. And then if there's any other information on my report, I'll entertain any questions.
Council, Mr. McIntyre.
Thank you for the report. I have one comment and a question. First of all, the pool ended up great, and I want to thank everybody for all the work they did. Just about everyone sitting up here, well, I think everyone sitting up here really did something to contribute, whether it was painting or donating or encouraging people to go to the pool. So a big thank you to everyone on council, because we all worked to make this possible. And I want to thank everyone in the community who donated as well. I know even Mr. Brosey made a very generous donation, and I want to say thank you for that. And so this was really a community effort, and we all pulled together to make the pool work this year. So thank you for that. The question I did have, I know in the past we have had issues with the income tax, with the delinquent income tax collection. I don't know if this is the right time to bring this up, but is this, are we improving in that, or do we not have those numbers yet? Is that an end of the year thing, end of the fiscal year thing?
I believe I had it in my report last month.
I may have missed that then.
Updated, yeah.
Okay.
We kind of do it quarterly, so I can go back and get a copy from our last month. They are down from this time. We still have not been able to have the time in the office to do any of the court collections, which is what we...
No, yeah, I understand that.
We're really wanting to get to that step, but the collection is less on the receivables, what we would, what are owed to us than it was this time last year.
Right, I realize we have a limited staff, and it's something we're always going to deal with, but I just want to thank you for keeping that as part of one of your priorities. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Reynolds.
Quick question, Colin. Do we have any more bills possibly going to come in at all?
That's what, everything in the red already accounts for what I'm anticipating coming in. I called all vendors.
So it could be less?
Pardon?
It could be less, or is that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then,
I don't expect it to be higher.
Okay, good deal. And my next question was, did we transfer money in from the general fund last year to cover?
We put 10,000.
Which is why we had to carry over.
Yes.
Gotcha. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lindsay, do you have anything?
I'm good.
Okay, well, I saw your hand.
Yeah, he jumped on that question. Yeah. That's good.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to just try and enlighten me a little bit, okay?
Okay.
On the revenue page, line 213, okay.
Which report are we, on my regular report?
On your regular report.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Line 213, which is the emergency ambulance operating budget. The amount budget was $670,354. Mm-hmm. Received to date was $436,282. But we only collect approximately $29,000, maybe some $30,000 a month. We're not going to make $670,000 out of that. Can't just enlighten me a little bit. You know, why did we budget so high in the revenue for the ambulance?
I actually would have to go back and look at all of our detail that goes into that, the amount that we budgeted, go back to some history to see, and then I can report to you before the next meeting.
Okay.
I can have something ready for you by the end of the week. Have the detail.
Okay, send me an email or whatever.
Sure will.
Just contact me. Okay, now number two thing is down in the water, 501. Okay, very similar situation. You know, we budget real high for revenue, but we're not going to get there. You know, we won't get there by the end of the year. Not with the numbers we're getting receiving. You know, same scenario. Why did we budget so high for the revenue?
The water revenue is $796,000 in our budget. We're at $596,000. We still have 3 months of revenue.
Yeah, but uncollected is $199,000. So that's like that.
And $70,000 a month times three, it's gonna hit those numbers.
You think so?
Yeah, I do believe the water's gonna be, it's gonna do well.
Okay.
Wastewater is coming in over since we ended up with the increase, so that's a good fund too.
Okay.
But I'll double check on the emergency ambulance.
Okay, you can see I have too much time on my hands today. I actually read. The next page on the expenses, the same thing on 213 and 502. It seemed like the expenses for the ambulance operating, you know, it's pretty high. You know, it's higher than what I would think. Is there any reason at this time that it was higher? Is it more runs? We need more equipment. We're paying for more equipment, or am I just in left field?
Again, I don't need my detail report, so I can give you a good answer. I'll put both of those together for you.
Okay. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Council, any other questions for Ms. Harris? Thank you, Ms. Harris. Appreciate your report.
Welcome.
Mr. Birch, back to you, sir.
Sure. And moving on with the city manager's report, our service discussion with our service director, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. I just have a couple items I'd like to update you with. Currently, we are repairing our catch basins. We have about five or six we're working on right now. And then we have about five or six that are, we'll be getting on, hopefully weather pending. We can get those done before the end of the year. Once we get those done, we are working on trying to finish up clearing a couple of trees that we still have dead in the parks. We got most of them in the spring, and then with dirt patching, we had to come off of that, but we'll get back on and get those done. The leaf pickup flyer is out. It starts this Monday, the 24th, with the first section. The flyer will be in the New Carlisle News. It will be on the website probably tomorrow when we email them. And then we do have flyers at the city building. And it describes on what each section, the town is broken up into four. Each get two pickups. And then we also allow the Old Madison Street School for you to be able to dump your leaves at. We just ask no rocks, limbs, anything like that that could damage equipment down the road that needs to use those leaves. A lot of times we'll donate those leaves to various businesses around and they use those for mulch. And also with that, with the our refuse hauler, the containers, you're allowed to put your leaves and stuff in those too. If for some reason you have a little pile, you can put them in there and not have to wait for us to pick them up with the leaf machine. And that is currently all I have. I can entertain any questions on those or anything else.
Mr. Kraybacher. Can I also make another suggestion on the leaves? Because the garden's been using the compost, the older ones. Let me make a new pile. Because I saw somebody the other day start throwing the newer leaves on top. And we just have to dig down deep, underneath there for it.
Out of a current compost pile we have
yes.
over there?
Yeah.
That is not.
They can move it on over.
I was going to say, that's probably not a compost pile solely. There's some other debris inside that other than leaves. I don't know if you...
But I haven't come in contact with anything like that. Cut up down underneath, there's some really good stuff.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So you want these leaves just moved over so you can still, can still get to the compost and stuff.
Yeah, right.
That's not a problem.
Because I saw somebody the other day would take bags and toss them on top, that's why.
Okay.
Council, any other questions for Mr. Kitko? Mr. Kitko, are we good to go for salt coming into the winter months?
Yes, we already have a salt vendor on order. Back when we got bids, I put that out that we come in, I think, another additional $10, I think less, $9. We're in a 50-some dollar range without going back to the flyer.
Is that less than last time?
That's less than last time?
Yes.
So, but we'll have enough on hand ready to go?
Yeah, we have a full barn already.
Okay.
We filled it up last year before the season ended, didn't get hit with anything.
Okay.
But we do have a contract for, or not a contract, just a, we have salt.
Gotcha.
I just can't think of the name I'm looking for.
Requisition.
Yes. We have 300 ton available to us.
Requisition. Mr. Reynolds.
Mr. Kitko, do you know, if our salt does run out, will we be able to get it on time? I know last year we weren't able to, and there was a whole lawsuit, which is probably why our price went down, because they were monopolizing on salt.
We paid more.
Our
company wasn't involved in the lawsuit whatsoever, but delivery, pending weather. We have a full barn, so if we get hard weather and everybody empties their barn at the same time, then yeah, we could get into a delivery issue, but that is possible.
Even though our salt wasn't provided to one of the monopolized companies, there was a press release that came out from the Attorney General's office where there were funds available to people who had overpaid for salt. And I really remember seeing New Carlisle was able to get like $300, $400. Did we ever receive that? Did we not apply for that?
I saw the press release from the Attorney General based on you could follow along with them in their class action, but there was nothing else that came to me on other than that.
All right, I'll have to go back and look it in for us. So, thank you.
We weren't eligible to participate.
Oh, there was a standard that was released of monies that were given to communities, and New Carlisle was listed as a community.
Yeah, I haven't seen anything, no emails, and I get all the emails from the Attorney General.
It was from last year. I'll go back and log.
Okay.
There was money released.
Mr. Lundgren?
On the list.
Mr. Kitko, how many tons do we have in the barn right now?
About 100.
100 tons? Thank you. How much do you normally use in a season?
We budget for 300.
Okay. Thank you.
But we won't need it this year, right?
It's going to be a very mild winter.
Mr. Reynolds, if there's something separate from the class action, I guess just to clarify, if there's something separate from the class action, we reviewed what was available through the class action, and
we weren't, we didn't qualify for anything associated with class action because our product wasn't associated with that. But if there's something separate.
There was something separate,
and apart
yes.
from the class action, would you let us know what that
yeah,
is?
Yeah, I'll go back
because
and look.
Because we're not aware of that.
Yeah, I'll go back and look.
Thank you, sir. All right, thank you, Mr. Kitko. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And moving on with our city manager report, our fire discussion with our fire chief, Chief Trusty.
Ethan,
yes.
Can you move that mic right to that center of that table?
So that's kind of something that's very unusual.
Thank you.
You've got a lot of people in the department at one time, and basically looking at the range, you're looking at the range structure of the fire department. Because with the amount of promotions that we're able to do in the past month or so, and bringing on a couple of our trainees, but it's a really good feeling to see department growing like it is, and the amount of knowledge and the amount of expertise that's coming to the table, especially in the officer ranks. But first, highest to lowest, tonight, promoting Captain Geiselman to Assistant Chief of EMS. She's also an LPN who works at Davie, lives in the city. She's also one of our lead CPR instructors. She's also the one that takes care of all the protocol testing each year that every EMS personnel has to do every year with the Minor Gala protocol system. She handles all that for us, and now she gets to do more. So, very big asset to the department. And then also Lieutenant Worley is being promoted to captain tonight. He's going to the position of captain of EMS. He's taken Chief Geiselman's job. Again, Captain Worley's been with the department for several years. He's also a paramedic with CareFlight. A lot of knowledge, a lot of experience with the department. He will be taking over, like I said, Chief Geiselman's position. He'll be handling a lot of the day-to-day operations for the EMS side of the house. Firefighter Dan Grimm will be going to the rank of lieutenant of EMS, taking Captain Alvarez's position. He's taken on one of the worst jobs in the department, is the scheduling for the part-time program. I don't want his job. I honestly tell you that it's probably the worst job in the department.
Yeah.
To try to schedule part-time people for a four-week period. You've got to understand, in the department, we have to cover 96 hours every day. Because we handle two stations, two personnel on each station for 24 hours, 96 hours. Has to be covered every day. It's going to be his job to make sure it's all done. Firefighter Schaefer, Paramedic Schaefer, will be going to lieutenant on the fire side of the house and be a final fire officer. Lieutenant Schaefer is also a paramedic. He also works with Bethel Clark, who is he's also a lieutenant there. A lot of years, again, time with our department, time with Bethel Clark. A lot of experience, a lot of knowledge. There's a lot of knowledge standing up here. There's a lot of experience standing up here. And they're all right here. And this is firefighter now, Linda Sizemore, also a paramedic. Her and the other firefighter just finished their firefighter level 1 course, which now allows them to be certified as a firefighter in the state of Ohio. You guys were there the day that we were doing a little bit of training.
Yep.
What you guys did that day, the day that they had ladder drills, they did that in between 15 and 20 times that day.
I'm gonna pass out doing it once.
A lot of hours, a lot of training, a lot of
academics also. It's just not out there humping those open ladders. They have to pass written tests, they have to pass a practical exam, and they also have to pass what's called a pull board exam, which allows their certification to travel with them. But part of our side group now. Firefighter now, Brooklyn Bell. When she first day she came in the office, and Captain Gosman, she works with Captain Gosman, Assistant Chief Gosman, came to the office, and well, she wants to join. I said, okay, and I was kind of busy at my desk, and looked up, and I thought I was looking at a 12-year-old kid. I'm serious, I really did.
Yeah.
My biggest fear was when they put an air pack on her back, she was going to fall over and look at her. But she stuck it out. She stuck out level one. She also got the award from the class during her quarter level one course of most improved, which is a lot to say, a lot in level one course. She went, they have what's called the speed drills in the course. They have to have their gear on complete, everything, boots, pants, gloves, helmet, everything, in less than a minute. And she went from the first couple of days, okay, I had to save it for me, to the end of the class and beating everyone in the class. She's now a firefighter, and coming up this year, she's planning on taking her EMT, which will bring her onto both sides of the house, which will be coming on the part-time program. Congratulations, Paul.
Chief, before they, because I know some of them will probably get going, I don't know if any of them are on duty right now or not, but just, you know, it seems like you and your entire crew has got things moving in such a positive motion forward. So, you know, big thanks to you and everyone on your staff for a good job.
Team effort.
Definitely.
Team effort.
Yes, sure.
Going on with our report, for the month of September, New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 78 EMS calls in the city. 5 EMS calls in the town in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 2 fire-related calls in the city and 0 in Elizabeth Township. We answered 3 EMS calls, 3 EMS calls were answered by mutual aid by Pike Township, Bethel Clark Township due to our medic already being on a response. We answered 2 mutual aid responses due to Bethel Clark or Pike Township. Medic 52A responded to 3 EMS calls, which means we were able to get our second medic out the door 3 times last month, which is a good thing. That means our medic was already on a response, and we had enough people living in the city to pick up the second medic and make a response. On the EMS side of the house, it's now Assistant Chief Geiselman. She taught 2 CPR classes for approximately 10 personnel at no cost to them. And then with the promotions, we're still doing the smoke detectors. We have, again, still about 50 left in the station that we're handing out. Again, I shouldn't say that. We're not handing them out. If someone comes and needs one, the crew will go to their house and install the smoke detector for them. That way we know it's installed correctly, in the proper place, and in the proper way, and to make sure it's working. Other than that, besides, we've had a kind of busy month with the festival this past month and a couple other things going on for fundraisers. That type of thing, and that's going well, real well. Besides that, that's about it. Any other questions?
Council, any questions for Chief? Mr. Reynolds?
Not a question, but a comment. You guys are doing a great job. I went out and did the training one day last month. Super hard. I thought I was gonna pass out. I've never sweated so much in my life. When I got the turnout gear off me, I was like, oh man, I was like, that must be all the water that seeped through the suit. And they're like, no, that's all your sweat. It was quite a tough job. So thank you guys for all that you do. And took you 60 seconds, it probably took me 10 minutes to get the suit back, the air pack on and get it tight, so thanks guys.
Council, any other questions, comments? Thank you, Chief, appreciate the report, excellent job, keep up the good work. Mr. Bridge.
And moving on with the, I'm going to wait till the room clears out a little bit. And moving on with the city manager's report, our police discussion with our police administrator, Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you, sir. Mayor, Council, here. The report for September, even though we're still experiencing some thefts in our city, we just had one vandalism for the month of September. And I just want you to remember, if you see a suspicious car or person, please give Clarke County Sheriff's Office a call. And also, we want you to give us the best description possible along with the direction of travel, if you have it. So the more information we get, the more likely we can find out if it's a bad guy or not. If you have any information about criminal activities, please contact Clarke County Sheriff's Office, and that's a 937-328-2560 number. Unfortunately, at the end of September, Deputy Jeff Boswell was working around his house when he fell and injured his right foot. Fortunately, he is going to need minor surgery and is going to be off for several weeks. Until Deputy Boswell returns to work, he'll be replaced by Deputy Nick Anderson. Deputy Anderson is an experienced deputy with several years working in the Uniform Patrol Division. I have to warn you, he worked nights. So if you've ever worked all night, you'll understand. He's a big tall guy, too. For the month of September, Nucleau deputies took 45 reports and Clarke County deputies took 24 reports for a total of 69 reports in Nucleau. And I don't want you to forget October 29th. It's Beggar's Night in Clarke County, and the hours will be 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. Everyone be safe. Watch out for little guys and girls. They're being sighted going from house to house getting treats. And please remember to check the treats for anything suspicious and give us a call. Even if you're uncertain, give us a call. We'll come and check it out. Now, along with our stats for the month, I'll go through those real fast. DV assault, we had one. Theft misdemeanors, we had 14. Theft felony, we had one. Now, that's still up some. Hopefully, with your help, we can get those numbers down. Overdose or attempted suicide, we had two. Miscellaneous drug offense, there were two. Vandalism, two. And phone harassment, one. Miscellaneous reports, and those reports not listed on this page, were 27. And unfortunately, we had accident with damage, we had four. That's a little bit high, too. Investigation, and that's traffic stops, there were seven. And along with that, we had 25 other traffic stops. And a miscellaneous citation, we had one. Under suspension, we had four. 911 hangups, we had 17. Alarms, we had 11. Assisted was 36. And a traffic detail, and some of them are considered that a traffic stop also. We had 21. Probate transport, and that's kind of unusual for Nucleau, but we did do one. Lockouts, we had three. Warrant misdemeanor arrest, one. Warrant felony arrest, three. Warrant misdemeanor issued, we had three. And arrest misdemeanor was three. And arrest felony, we had one. So those are all good arrests. Miscellaneous calls, this is of the four deputies, are 89. And it says township complaint, but that's actually city complaints. We did have six. So it was a busy month for the deputies. With that, I'll entertain any questions or comments.
Thank you, Sergeant. Council, any questions from the Sergeant tonight? Mr. McLaughlin?
Are we still utilizing the bicycles?
Yes, we are.
The girls around the city? Are they working the bike path and so forth?
They're working the bike path. They're around the city. They're also on foot patrolling the businesses, too. So that's a good thing.
Good. Thank you.
If I can chime in on that, I have received, not a lot, maybe one or it's actually happened twice, about how effective the bicycles are being, that I've got a call that our sheriff is riding her bike during her shift and she should be in a car. So obviously they are being noticed. So I'd explain to the people that that is her patrol car for the day. And when she realized that, she was ecstatic. So they are being noticed.
Thank you.
Good.
Sergeant, I have a question. What time, when will they decide to put the bikes up for the season? Once it just...
They may even have them out as late as November and December. Just depends on the weather. If we get a couple warm days, they'll be out on the bikes as much as possible.
I think Rachel likes the bike riders as a person.
Thank you.
So, yeah, there's no set rule.
Okay. Council, any other questions, comments? Thanks, Sergeant. I appreciate it. Mr. Bridge, back to you, sir.
Thank you. And moving on with the city manager report is our informational items. If I can actually ask, I'm actually going to do this next presentation right over here by this window, so I'm going to get up and walk across there. But in the meantime, can I please have...
And Councilman Lowry, can you start with... Going to need Mr. Ethan Reynolds up here, Mr. Bill Lindsay up here. This is Shannon Scott. If you're here, please come up. Mr. Richard Reynolds, Mr. Kelly Reynolds, and this is Emily Cook. And this is Cook here? No? This is more about you guys than about me. I just invited everyone here to, well, with the exception of our two council members who should be here anyway. These awesome citizens have volunteered to start doing some cleanups in some of our parks around town. New Carlisle Park and Willowood Park to this day look 100% better thanks to the volunteerism of these individuals up here. I did send a letter out to each individual. I would just like to take time to read that here. So on behalf of the city of New Carlisle, I would like to thank you for the recent cleanup work you have performed at various parks around our city. This beautification effort makes the park more inviting for our citizens and our guests. It is amazing how new paint, litter removal, graffiti removal, and citizen commitment to bettering where they live can make a world of difference. I am very pleased with how the Willowood Park sign and how the park shelters appear to the public, very fresh and clean. The City of New Carlisle appreciates all the time and hard work you have dedicated to this project. In order to publicly thank you, I would like to invite you to the next City Council meeting on Monday, October 17th, out here at the Shelter House. The meeting begins at 7 p.m. On behalf of this office of the city manager, and I'm sure on behalf of the office of the mayor, we do appreciate what you've done. Again, the parks look fantastic. We have received a few phone calls regarding the improvements. They are noticeable, but it is citizens like you, every city, needs volunteer work. I don't care how affluent your city is or how poor it is. Without volunteer work, you don't get ahead, and these fine citizens had given that an awesome example of how volunteer work is better, not only where you live, but for people to come in and visit your city. So thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I gotta find my spot.
Still have the ball, sir.
All right. This next item down here said waste management contract information to come to citizens. I was really hoping to have the new flyer back to me in my hands today. Unfortunately, that did not come. So for those of you who do not know, City Council did vote to go with waste management for our next contract. There will be some changes to the type of service that you can have, and also just some changes in what you can put in your trash. And also there might be a slight change of where your trash is actually picked up if you were currently getting it tucked up in an alley. So as soon as we get the information from waste management, I will definitely pass it on to our citizens. We're asking at this point in time, you do not call waste management because they don't have it set up on their end with the terms of the new agreement that was just passed. But again, council did approve that waste management contract without the administration fee. So you'll see a reduction on your, you will see a reduction on what it would have been if we would have had the admin fee. So more information pertaining to that will come in the future.
Mayor. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't. Mr. Reynolds, I don't know who was first.
I had a quick question about the garbage bags. Uh-huh. So let's say you bought a plethora of them and then you start using them and then November 30th hits and the new contract goes into use. Can you sell back those bags, continue to use them until they're gone?
How that's going to work is once you purchase them from the city building, they're yours, okay? Mm-hmm.
And that's a good question, by the way, Mr. Reynolds. I did speak with Waste Management about that. They will accept your bags if you're currently on the bag program. They will give you probably 1 or 2 weeks of still being picked up on that bag, but after that, you will need to call and get a service level, whether it be the 35-gallon, the 64-gallon, or the 96-gallon. But they will, during that transition, for a week or two after that, still take your trash if you haven't called and chose what level of service that you did have.
Okay.
The bags that we have at the city building that were not sold to our citizens, we will get credit back. I'll return those, essentially.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. Also, on that same subject, the city's also going to plan on getting the different size trash cans and putting them on display, like up at the side of the building.
Yep.
So people need to come up and look to see what size they need, correct? We're still going to.
We actually got those last week. They are in the back conference room. As soon as we get the okay from Waste Management, we are going to put them out front.
Okay.
Yep. But we do have the three sizes to choose from.
Correct.
And they are taking up a lot of room. We have a small space.
No, he just, that was the question I wanted to know if they had in the city building, and he just answered that that's just too
Mr. McLaughlin?
If I may add to that, if you do put them out, could we put the price of each one on there as well?
Sure.
And the senior rate?
Yeah.
Because people need to be made aware of that.
Absolutely.
If they have now the large one, they want to go down a step or two steps.
Sure.
And the senior rate, they'll know that then.
Absolutely.
Might be nice to make something up and put on them.
Sure.
Thank you.
I agree with you.
Council, any questions on this subject?
Thanks, sir. All right. And moving on with the city manager's report. Council members, you may see in your packet the quote for the shelter house floor. We are looking, we are simply just starting the process. We are looking into getting our floor repaired. We did get a company, local company, just right outside of town here, who did 571 Bar and Grill's floor. They came in last week and gave a presentation to myself, Mr. Mayor, and Mr. McLaughlin. This is the panel, the design, I guess you can say, that the council members, the two that were present, decided to go on. You'll see in that quote that he is graciously giving a charitable contribution of around $3,300. The total price to do this shelter house floor would come in at $8,500 with a 50% deposit due. So that'd be a $4,250 deposit. So basically, that's the sample of what council's deciding to do. We've got some big plans for the shelter house coming up in 17. We do want to do an addition to have a kitchenette in there as well. This shelter house is on very high demand. We actually lose a lot of rentals based on it already being rented, or we don't have any place to store or prepare food. So we're going to try to invest back into this. This is going to be solely a council decision on whether they go through with that or not. There is no legislation for that tonight. I did want to just introduce that to the remaining council members and then also see what the big sample looked like as well. So it will be in the coming weeks, possibly an ordinance to go through with that. I do expect the council members to talk amongst themselves at some point in time to decide what they think is the best way for the city. I have talked to Mr. Kitko about this. You know, an alternative thing that we could probably do is power wash this and paint it with, and forgive me the name, I call it basement paint. Is that the technical term?
Garage floor paint.
Garage floor paint. So a few options, but again, that's gonna be left to decide through the council members.
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge, how much would it cost to use the garage floor paint?
I don't think we got quotes. I mean, how much? We would do that in-house. We would supply the work. How many, I don't think we've quoted how many gallons you're going to need and all that stuff yet, have we?
Yeah, we haven't quoted that out, but not expensive other than filling some of the seams.
Okay, that has a non-skid type paint too, correct?
Just a little bit, enough that you can sweep and not carry more dust up as you keep sweeping.
Is that something that you could add sand to before you put it down on the ground to get
it usually
back?
Comes with a little bit of an anti-skid in it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. How long does it last?
Long.
Does it?
There's also something out there called garage floor epoxy paint. Is that what you're talking about?
That's what this would be. Yeah.
Okay.
Same thing.
All right. Thank you.
Well, me as the city manager will play both sides of the fence here. All right. Just keep in mind, what's the final product going to look like? How's it going to fit to the overall appearance inside and outside of the shelter house? And is it the best move for the city? Just keep those few things in mind, then we will respect whatever decision council makes.
Mr. Bridger, can we touch on what the other possible, we talked about it earlier in the year, a possible second update that we were thinking about going? Can we touch on that at all right now?
The kitchenette?
Right.
I mentioned that earlier.
Did you? Okay.
Yes. No, you're good. I thought you were going to go with the other type of flooring.
No, okay.
Which is double the price. I didn't want to bring that up.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
No problem. Any other questions on the flooring? No?
Nope. Thank you.
All right. And we got one more item under informational, and that is the New Carlisle Health Stats. The information is attached to there, the council packets. So any questions on that, just give me a call, and we'll shoot it off to the appropriate agency to get that answered.
No questions. Thank you.
I have a comment.
Mr. McLaughlin?
We're talking about the health levy on this. The health levy is coming up also November the 8th. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen any signs or anything out so far. Are we promoting this at this point?
Now, that is done by a health levy committee. Yes, that will be done.
That
will be done. I know they just got all the copies made.
Okay.
They are securing the big signs to put at city entrances. We didn't meet. Something that you don't want to put out way too early because you don't want people to forget about it. So I think in the next week or two, you're going to see a lot of activity on that.
I think we should also say that it's a renewal. You're paying it already at this point. It's a very valuable thing for the city to have.
Sure. And all the papers we have coming out, stress renewal. Absolutely.
We'll have one other council meeting before that.
Sure.
Actually,
mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Bridge?
And I do believe that's all I have for my city manager's report. I'd be happy to entertain any questions or comments.
Any questions or comments from city managers? All right, we will move on. Thank you, sir. Appreciate the report. And we will move down to some measure comments from the members of the public. Anybody in the public have any comments? Just if you could, please, ma'am, just go to the podium and give us your name and address.
Hi, my name is Lee Riffle. I live on Prentice Drive. And for the last month, I've had a very dirty front yard. I guess I could pass it. You guys can look at it. I went to the city and I filed a complaint, and that was over 30 days ago, to have the trash removed off of the curb. And these people have had this trash on their curb for 3 months, according to the other neighbors that live around them. And it's on my street. It's 307 Prentice Drive. And they gave me to the street department. The street department said they couldn't, it's not their department, it's the easement department. And the lady at the water department says, I don't even know who that is. So I come tonight to plea to try to get this trash cleaned up off my
head. It's Mr. Lindsay, we'll pass it down.
These people don't move their trash cans. They just fill them up on their curb, and the trash man comes and takes it, and they leave them right there to be filled up. If we continue to allow that to sit there, then everyone will be doing it, cleaning their trash cans.
What is the address on that property?
307 Prentice Drive. I talked to the neighbors. We just bought a house across the street. We bought one in our neighborhood, trying to clean our neighborhood up. Our realtor said that we are the heroin district, so I'm not really sure why we're pointing a phrase for a particular district. But I think it's in the
heroin
district. So we get that. That's
cleaned up. Ma'am, is that house vacant across the street?
No, it isn't.
Not
307.
Oh, that's 307 Ross.
307, the people have lived there for probably 10 years, but this isn't the first time they've done this.
Yeah. I think, can I say something?
Yeah, Mr. Kerbach.
Can
I just handle it right now and be done with it?
Yeah, just get rid of it.
No,
he's got a comment. Go ahead, Mr. Kerbach.
Explain to her what's going on.
Okay, then go ahead.
I don't have the code enforcement records in front of me. That is done by our code enforcement officer. Let me see this house. His name's Jim Clark. I'll look into this because he's pretty good at tagging stuff, and to be honest with you, that part of town we tag a lot in. whether it be for tall grass or trash outside the house. So I'm going to find out exactly why this was tagged. When did you personally notice that?
I turned in my complaint over 30 days ago. I bought the house across the street to fix up and sell.
Sure.
And I came up with this picture last week. I took this picture up to the lady at the water department.
Our water department?
Yes.
Who did you speak with?
The lady at the front desk that takes your money.
Oh, that's not our water department. Gotcha. Okay, because she's out. So I didn't want to know exactly who you spoke to. Have they removed any trash on this before? Have they, like, taken an item out and put it back? Because here's the reason I'm asking you this question. We send our code enforcement guy out. He can tag the property, okay? They have X amount of days to correct the property, depending on it's 5 days, plus you have to give them an extra, I think, almost 2 weeks for them to allow it to, for them to clean it up. In the meantime, if they go out there and they move one item off of that thing, he has to start the whole process over again. So a lot of times when you tag people, especially if they're habitual offenders, they know the game. If you know, like if we send our police department, we send the cop out to chalk your tires. If you move it 1 inch, you're good to go. You know, as long as you move that car a little bit, you're fine. So. I'm talking about the swimming pool and the other stuff. If they go out and they take a little bit away.
That's not a swimming pool. That is one of
those
dumpsters in a bag.
Okay.
Oh, really?
Got you. That changes. All right. So they need to call the crash company to pick that up.
Sure.
Got you.
Yes.
Now, at the same time, again, I have to look at the records because we do tag them. They still have X amount of time by law to clean it up. And if they call, if you call, anybody calls and they say, hey, I need another week to get this cleaned up, we're going to give you that extension. So I need to find out where exactly in the violation process we're at with this. Okay?
Miss Ma'am, can we take your information down just so that we can let her know?
In the future, if you could actually deal with this through our code enforcement department, not our water department,
okay, well,
that would be great.
Tell her.
Nobody
gave me that information.
Sure.
I
would
call
her family. Sure.
She needs to go to the city building.
She knows
where
we're going.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Bridge, can we take down our information so we can give her a call and an update on it?
Hold on, Mr. Rhodes. Mr. Lowry, go ahead.
I think it's important to point out, if anyone's trying to defraud an order, like if someone's just trying to move something just to defraud an order, we won't tolerate that.
I'll be honest with you.
So we will, and he wasn't saying that we'll let someone try to be sneaky to get around an order. He'll figure out where this is in the process, because we understand that you're very frustrated. He'll figure out where this is in the process, and then we'll deal with it and make sure that it's in the process. Someone will follow up with you and let you know where it's at, and we'll make sure that it's taken care of.
Because I do believe it is a city ordinance that you can't fill your trash cans up on the curb. Is that correct?
You have to remove it.
Yes.
Okay.
You take it up by your house, you dump your trash in, and you move it back to the curb on that Monday.
You have 24 hours, I do believe, or something like that, to remove it back to the curb. We have one code enforcement officer for the entire. I'm not trying to make excuses, I'm being very honest when I say this. We have one code enforcement officer for the whole town of 6,000. You know, and he's part time. You know, so it's hard to catch some stuff. And I'll be honest with you, a lot of the time he focuses on stuff that are a much bigger problem. You know, so if he hasn't tagged this, which I can't say for sure he hasn't, I don't have the records in front of me. But again, he's in that part of town a lot, you know, so we'll figure out if he's tagged it or not. If he hasn't tagged it, we'll get the process started. But there's rights that they have that we have to elect them to try to alleviate the problem first.
So when you're there working on your house, if you're noticing new issues that you think are problematic, you don't need to pull out the code. Just snap a picture like you've done, because this is very helpful, and just bring it into the office.
and get it to the code enforcement officer, get it to Mr. Bridge, and then we can get it followed up on and get it into the process. Because this, with a date on it, and this tells the story. So we'll be able to follow up on it with that. But this.
It's really upsetting because I actually live in Northern Hoover. I'm right on the same street, so I have to live there every day.
Unfortunately, just with the reduction in funding from the state down to the very bottom, most smallest fish, the number of positions in the city have been reduced. And one of them is that the code enforcement went part-time, just like he's doing three jobs. And he's taken a number of positions and filled them. So that's just one of the many changes that the city has experienced in order to keep the bottom line continuing to be flush. This can be taken care of.
Mr. Lowry.
I'm sorry, I'm going to upset someone, but I don't like the excuses you gave her, okay?
I don't think
I'm just
going to
be straight out with you.
Listen,
excuse me. If there's a problem, you just said that people know how to play the game.
They do.
Okay.
I did code enforcement for 44 years in the city.
Okay. But then it's our job, all of us' job, to fix that so they can't play the game. If you tell me that you go out and tag one item and they move it and bring it back, they're clear, then we tag every item.
I think you misunderstood
so
what I was saying by that. What I'm saying is there's ways around this stuff.
Okay.
If we go and tag somebody, I don't know if this has been moved since 3 months ago.
Oh,
I mean, I'm just saying, for example, this could have been moved back four or five times by the time.
And I agree with you, it may have.
I don't
know. But if it's an ongoing problem, if I live across the street from it, I know there's going to be some serious problems.
When you are
we need to really look at it and fix it so that can't happen.
I understand what you're saying. I totally
okay.
get it. I get it.
Okay.
But when you're a city of this size and the resources that we have, you can expect things like this to fall through the crack.
But if it's been going
he's
on,
coming
what,
off,
say 3 months?
We are coming
three
off
months?
A code enforcement officer that works maybe 13 hours a week.
Right.
And in the spring and summer, he really has to focus on tall grass.
We'll talk about that after the meeting.
You know, so I'm not saying this is acceptable by any means, but I'm just saying there's a reason it's like this. And it's because we have one code enforcement officer who works 13 hours a week.
Then I've got something to that because the house right next door to that always has high grass. So that guy himself, if he's the guy that goes out there and mows that grass, then he's seen that for 3 months because that greenhouse right next door to them is empty and it always has to have a yard mowed. So they've been over there and mowed that yard at least once a week.
And I'm sure, we haven't mowed it. City hasn't mowed it once a week.
The city was just out there last week.
I'm sure they were, but we don't mow grasses every week at a single property.
No,
we just don't. I'm telling you right now, we don't.
If you do it once a week mm-hmm. or two times a month. It's been there 3 months, and if you're saying that the code enforcement guy is in charge of that, and he's also the guy that mows the grass.
He didn't say that the code enforcement had most of the grass.
The code enforcement people do not mow the grass?
No.
The
city does.
Our street crew goes out and mows the grass.
Well, so then your street crew couldn't...
Our street crew don't issue violations. Our code enforcement officer guy issues violations.
Will we turn them into the city when they see problems such as that?
I'm sure they're not trained to see what's a problem or not. That's not their job description. And they're unionized employees, so. Yeah.
The best solution.
The guy is the one that turns the grass in, right?
Yes.
That's what you're saying.
But here.
If you guys only mow once a month, he's seen it three times.
Again, I don't know if he's tagged the property or not. He may have tagged his property. I don't know. You guys are making assumptions that he has or has not. I don't know if he has or not. If he has not tagged the property, then what you're saying is 100% accurate. He's seen it three times.
Okay.
And that's basis if he has not tagged it properly. I'm not sure.
Right.
I'm not sure.
Okay, let's, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge,
mm-hmm.
you will check into this
absolutely.
Tomorrow
I'll check
morning.
Absolutely, check in the morning.
Whenever. And if
he hasn't tagged this in 3 months, but he's been tagging the yard next door for grass. You might ask him why.
Well, I'll tell you why, because I've done his job for 4 years. When you're going down the street and you're going down one way, you look back and forth. I'm not making excuses for the guy. I'm just simply, I've been in that position before.
Right.
This is probably the hardest job in the entire city. Code enforcement is tough. I'm not making excuses for the guy. When I did it for 4 years, and I did a pretty darn good job at it, to toot my own horn, you miss a lot of stuff by going down the street. You do.
Okay. But you'll check into it tomorrow and, sure, and try to find a remedy for it?
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Dewey, just 1 second, Dewey. I think also, I mean, I don't think, in Randy's defense, I don't think he's trying to sweep it under the rug. I think it's just uncertainties as far as he doesn't know exactly where it is in the process. Dewey, go ahead, buddy.
I have a neighbor back of me that his shrubbery is moving over. It's at least 8 feet on the other side of my fence. And on the east side, the lady there, she can't even get her clothesline anymore. It's overgrown. It's been going on for 6 years. It's a tree on his side, honeysuckle. My daughter used to cut it back every year, but since then, it's taken over everything.
Have you given that address to Randy before, or someone at the same building? Oh, okay. Did you give that address to someone at the city building? Can you give that to Randy?
Dewey, what's the address?
Pardon?
What is the address?
Five 10 Madison.
510 West Madison.
Madison.
West?
Yeah. Yep.
And this was tall shrubs?
We've talked to him, but he won't. You can't talk to him because he won't listen.
Okay.
And I want it cut down on his side, not my side, because it won't come back again.
Okay. So it's his side that's the problem?
Hmm?
His side's growing to his side.
It's unbelievable.
Thank you, Dewey. Let Randy take a look at it. All right?
Ma'am, can I have this, or do you want to back?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. You sure?
Okay.
Thank you, Dewey. Anybody else have any questions or comments tonight? All right. Let's move on to no resolutions tonight, so we'll move down to ordinances. Mr. Collier, when you're ready.
Mayor, before we actually get into the ordinances, we need to suspend the rules of council to move ordinance 16-44E down underneath or after the executive session.
After the executive session. Could we also move it or say suspend the rules of council to be like, we're voting on it after the session, or can we vote before? I'm guessing we're voting after because...
No. The request is to have once we have our discussion, then it would be voted on when we came back into regular session.
Okay.
So you need a motion to suspend rules and move the ordinance.
So moved.
By Mr. McLaughlin.
Second.
By Mr. Lowry.
So just to clarify, we will come back in to regular session
yes.
to mm-hmm. vote on that. Is that there, correct?
And he can state that when we get to that point.
Thank you.
Mr. McIntyre.
And the reason for moving it for the public is because in the executive session is related to
correct.
This piece of legislation.
Right. Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Passes 7-0. Now back to the ordinances. Ordinance 16-37, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance amending the estimated resources of the city of New Carlisle to the county auditor that will be available to appropriate for the fiscal year 2016.
Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lowry. Motion to adopt ordinance 16-37.
Second.
An explanation of this ordinance. This ordinance will increase our estimated resources for fiscal year 2016 due to the purchase of the sewer jet and the selling of the Twin Creek parcels.
Council, any questions? Mr. Collier, when you're ready. Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Krabach?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Passes 7-0. Ordinance 16-38, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance supplementing certain appropriations of the city of New Carlisle, ordinance 16-10.
Council Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Move we accept ordinance 16-38.
Second.
In explanation of this ordinance will allow the city to spend the previous appropriations I described in ordinance 16-37, which is the backhoe and the Twin Creeks parcels.
Council, any questions? First, your call. Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Krabach?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 7-0. Ordinance 16-41, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for liability insurance with USI Insurance Services, LLC, representing the public entities pools of Ohio for the administration of said policy.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lauer.
Motion to adopt ordinance 16-41.
Second.
Mr. McIntyre.
An explanation of this ordinance will allow the city to continue on having liability insurance with USI.
Council, any questions? Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge.
Yes.
This is a policy that we currently have?
That's a policy that we that we are going to renew, yes.
Okay. Do you check with other companies to see if we can get this cheaper?
We are in with Public Entities Pool of Ohio, so as soon as we can leave that, we can look at other places.
So that isn't an option?
Not right now.
Okay. Thank you.
Go ahead. Mr. Reynolds.
Why can't we leave them and go find out?
Because they're in a pool. We can't leave until the, I think we're done with the pool in end of
next year.
17.
Mr. McLaughlin.
I'd just like to bring up that I had talked to our city manager on this. We have a $500 deductible for physical damage on auto physical damage and property physical damage. I would like, and I'd ask him to check into it, which he is doing, to find out if we can save substantial money by going to a $1,000 deductible, which is basically, that's a deductible that most people have now on property damage. So I would like, we will know that here in the next few days, but I would not want to hold this contract up. That's not what I'm saying. But we will find out if there's a substantial amount difference, if there is, and we may have to bring it back to change that. That is possible, I believe.
I think once you sign this, I think it's set in stone. I don't think that they're going to allow us to change it to $1,000 deductible. Now, don't quote me on that.
No, I don't agree with that, because if we move things in and out, vehicles, so forth, by another property, whatever, they will add or subtract whatever at that point. Again, I've spent 30 years in the business, sure. So it's a situation that I think it's well worth looking at. And I know you're doing it, so we'll find out what happens with it. It may not be a substantial difference, but it would be worth looking at.
What, in your opinion, what is a substantial difference on the premium cost?
Well, we're looking at a raise of $2,800 increase over what we had. But we've added we evidently added a couple more vehicles than what we had before. I don't know. I'd like to see the figures. Again, $1,000 deductible nowadays is a normal deductible, especially commercial insurance. Sometimes it's $2,500, sometimes $5,000.
Sure.
It depends on are you willing to self-insure for that deductible? That's what it boils down to. Mm-hmm. Are you going to save a appreciable amount of money at that point? I think it's worth looking into. Just wanted to bring that up.
Thank you, Mr. Redick. Well, anybody else? Mr. McIntyre.
I had a question for Mr. Bridge. Sorry.
You're good.
Based on what Mr. McLaughlin was saying, and he does know insurance probably better than any of us here, looking at the ordinance, the start date for the contract is 1 November 2016. Does that mean if this isn't passed now, we would be in a situation where we would not have liability and property insurance as a city until, unless there was some sort of special meeting or whatnot? But if we don't pass this now, we would be in a phase where we don't have
it. I would recommend you guys passing it and then amending it. You don't want to get yourself into a situation where there's any kind of overlap.
I know for a fact that there's a, and you're not talking about shopping for different coverage, but I know with this particular carrier, they have, I think, at least a 6 month out notice date to shop other carriers. And you obviously can't go without coverage. I mean, I would recommend you absolutely can't go without coverage.
Absolutely. So,
is your notice, is your renewal date November 1st?
If what?
Yes.
It's November 1st.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre. Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge, I know you have a calendar on you and I do not. I know you have a calendar and I do not. Can we have another meeting prior to this expiring or not?
Can I ask council a question?
Sure.
This is the second reading of this ordinance. Second. You had a first reading on it 2 weeks ago. This is something that should have been discussed 2 weeks ago, not the day before we sent it off to be discussed.
But if I'm not wrong, we're not allowed to discuss them on the first reading. It's the second reading that we discuss them.
You're more than welcome to ask me questions anytime you want on that, even if it's something you call me out of the office.
But I think because if council has all these questions, it would be more prudent to do it at a council meeting than to do it on the first reading when we're not allowed to ask those questions anyways.
Now, I think what he's saying is you're welcome to go to him at his office and talk about it.
So you'd want all seven of us bothering you seven different days?
That is your job as council members.
That's at our pleasure.
You might want to start reading legislation when you get it.
I do.
So here's the deal. I know Shannon pretty good at USI. She's a great person.
Yeah.
Honestly, I don't think we're going to see much of a cost saving by going up to $1,000 deductible. Because here's the deal, we have 6-7 claims this year. What if we have 20 claims next year? Now we're paying $500 more than what we have to pay this time around. We'll get the numbers back. I'm sure if we want to go with a different policy, USI will have no problem reopening it up to us. This is not due to November 1st. So when we get these numbers, push comes to shove, we'll have to call a special meeting.
Anything else, Mr. Lindsay?
No, I'm good, thank you.
Sure.
Council?
Mr. Mayor. I definitely recommend that we go ahead and pass
yeah.
it. This can be adjusted later on with no trouble at all if we find out different figures at that point. But we don't want to put the city in jeopardy for not having coverage. So we do need to go ahead and pass this, in my estimation, I'm saying.
Thank you, Mr. McLaughlin.
You're welcome.
Just one small comment. I'm very familiar with this insurance, and if we have a vehicle hit, one of our decorative poles are hit, and they have no insurance, I usually handle the claim in-house so we don't pay the deductible. So far I've had 100% recovery from insurances I work with. That could change any time, but only on one that was hit at Studebaker's where it's unknown, nobody, we didn't know. I had to go through our insurance and use the $500 deductible, but I try not to go through our own if I can get it done with myself and do any invoicing. It's really not much time on my part, it's just making sure it gets done.
Sure. Thank you.
I think it's very wise to shop for that, but I'm just saying I wouldn't hold our breath. One and two, this should definitely be passed tonight. One last.
Mr. Reynolds.
So if we do pass this, can you start looking for other options? Because we have to have 6 months cancellation.
So why not?
Here's our other option. We're going to renew with the USI based off of what their current quotes are going to be.
In 6 months, if we were to want to shop again, I wouldn't get in the same situation that we're in now.
Oh, okay, well, moving forward.
Yeah, well, I'm saying like right now, like if we vote yes on this, start doing our research now. So in 6 months, we can say, hey, here's your advance warning before this cancels out by 2017.
Sure.
So that we're not debating this again and like, oh, well, we would like you to do X, Y, Z, but now we're stuck up the creek without a paddle.
I have no problem doing that, and that's probably the most reasonable, responsible thing to do. I will give preference to who we're with now if they're a little bit off, because I know the history of this company and I know how fantastically well they work with myself and Mr. Kitko and how responsive they are to our needs. You know, so I don't just look at price for things. Sometimes what service level you get for customer service comes into play, especially if you get something fixed or not. You know, so it's going to take a lot, and I do mean a lot, for us to go move away from USI because of that 100% responsiveness that we get from them. It's like when we said at the Waste Management Special Contract Meeting, since Waste Management has that office in Fairborn, I have everything I need fixed in 15 or 20 minutes, every single time. You know, so I have no problem shopping for other people, but it's going to be hard to beat the customer service levels that we get with USI.
We want to know if you don't try.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Any other questions? Mr. Collier, when you're ready. Mr. Reynolds?
Mm-hmm. No.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes, we need to.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
I guess if I had a big problem, I should have brought it up 2 weeks ago. Thank you for pointing that out. So, yes.
Okay.
That's true. It's
true. Mayor, the next two ordinances are just introductions tonight. Ordinance 16-43, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 11-7-16. An ordinance authorizing an agreement with the City of Cleveland, Ohio for services related to income tax collections. Ordinance 16-45, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 11-7-16. An ordinance amending sections 220 of the codified ordinances of the City of New Carlisle, Ohio regarding the city manager. Thank you, sir. Moving on to other business. When you're ready, or would you like to move it if you like? Only thing under other business is trick or treat night will be Saturday, October 29th from 6 to 8 p.m. All right, and we will move down to the executive session tonight, which is to discuss pending litigation for the Kennedy Trust litigation and Bartlett versus Collier.
Need a motion to enter executive session?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we enter into executive session.
Second.
And Mayor, we'll have a 5 minute break.
Quick 5 minute break.
There will be business. Mr. McLaughlin?
There will be business.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Passes 7-0.
17-18 after.
Okay, we're on break.
5 minutes.
I didn't know our show was
ready. Yes, sir. Mr. Collier.
Ordinance 16-44E, a public hearing in action tonight, an ordinance approving settlement of Kennedy Trust litigation and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lowry, go ahead.
Mr. Lowry. Motion to adopt ordinance 16-44E.
Second.
Gotcha.
Sorry about that.
Now, explanation, this ordinance, this will allow the city to have closure from the Kennedy Trust lawsuit.
Amen.
And we like the word closure.
closure.
Hallelujah. Any council?
Let's do it. I have a question.
Are you serious?
Well, you'll like this one, right? Do you have any idea how much money this whole thing has cost the city? From the time it started to the time we ended?
Mr. Lilly,
you know
I keep pretty good records, right?
Yeah.
You'd have to go give me
one. I figured you'd have that in your head.
I do, I think, but I'm not, I want to verify it. Before.
Is it like $7 million or something?
You'd have to go way back.
And I'll be honest with you, this is not going to be a total thing because I don't know how far back this goes. You got to understand, I was just in it since I've been in it.
Gene could probably tell us how far back. I think Gene was mayor back then or something.
So this is Gene's fault?
It's funny, John.
Sorry.
Was it?
All right. You got it?
Because I came on when...
Okay, now, how long has this been going on? Before I say this announcement, how long has this been going on?
Seven? Since 07?
Well,
okay, I don't go...
No, wait a minute, how long has it been going on since we...
No,
okay,
was McKee's
this is probably not a true amount, to be honest with you, because I can only go back so far. I can only use what the information I have in front of me. But the numbers I have are $35,851.66.
Honestly, I thought it was
not. I think you need to double that at least, or if not triple it.
All right. Any questions or comments?
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Lindsay?
No, I'm good. I'm just curious.
Mr. Collier, when you're ready.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Absolutely.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Passes 7-0.
Council, any other discussion tonight?
Yes.
Mr. Lowry?
You want her on camera?
Oh, yes.
There is one more.
Smile.
You're on camera, Ken?
I think what she's wanting to know is what we want her to do.
Yeah, if you want to elaborate, now you can do so.
Certainly.
Could you put the camera on the wall director? Thank you.
Recently, the city of New Carlisle had a writ of mandamus filed in the Second District Court of Appeals. That is a legal paper that was filed by one of its citizens asking the clerk, Mr. Collier, to take a petition that the citizen had filed to the Board of Elections to have signatures certified in order for the petition to be placed on the ballot. And the clerk didn't do that for reasons that he disputed that the petition was not valid and sufficient. The Court of Appeals ruled against the city, stating that the clerk had to take the petition to the Board of Appeals or to the Board of Elections, and so the clerk did that. And the city, to further advocate and advance its arguments, filed a protest with the Board of Elections, which is its right to do. And last week, a hearing was held on that protest. After holding the hearing that the city appeared for and the citizen appeared for, the board went into an executive session and voted in the city's favor. And the signatures were removed, and the issue will not go on the ballot.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Can you sign that?
Sure.
And any other questions or comments before we move on?
Mr.
Collier?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
Adjourn.
Thank you.
I was just pointing.